Good morning, everybody. I hope you enjoyed your breakfast and, you know, found it easy to get here. So just now the two presentation are they are for adults. Now this one is for the kids here. So as like any other parent, I constantly worry about my kids. So, you know, now I think you know that jobs are getting harder to predict and careers are more short-lived. So, you know, one way is you have to learn how to manage capital. So managing capital, I think, is important. And, you know, some kids, they may not want to learn that or they have no interest. So I have devised a way. I've devised a 5-minute investment strategy for young adults or for kids or for people who don't want to who can't get onto the aggregate bandwagon. So this 5-minute investment process is something that, you know, is motivated by my daughter. She's sitting there, so I'm trying to tell her how to invest in 5 minutes. You don't need to know, she doesn't know how to calculate book value, dividend yields, ROE, and so on and so forth. Let me present this simple method. All you need to know is, you need to know ABC, that's all. Then later I explain why this investment method can actually work. So first, as a young adult or as a kid, what do? You try to save money. You try to at least save half your salary. And where do you get money from when you are growing up? So you can take money elsewhere or by making choices like this. Singapore is peculiar. Singapore has no snow, but most of the kids, they know how to ski. So, you know, sometimes you don't have to do that. That's where you can get money for your investment. You can do things like that. It's only like 20 bucks cycling in Pulau Ubin. And I think probably your kid wouldn't know the difference between riding a bike or skiing. They were equally, they have equal good fun. Okay, so this is the investment process, the 5-minute investment process that I'm going to tell my kid. First, imagine it's 1998. So your mission in life is to acquire all the stocks in the stock market, starting with A up to Z. So where are you going to get the money, right? So like I say, you save money all the time. So every month, you try to get something. So in 1998, you buy all the stocks starting with A. And you make sure you diversify across countries because there could be another incident of clop or whatever, or it could be a long-term decline in Japan. So what do? So in Singapore, you buy starting with A. So you start with ABR Holdings. Then in Hong Kong, Aeon Credit. In Malaysia, in Japan, in USA, in UK. So you just buy companies at the top of the alphabetical list. And what do with your salary that you have saved? You put equal amounts into each stock. So for example, in 1 year, you have actually saved $24,000 and you use that $24,000 to buy 6 stocks in 1998. So in 1998 until today, you don't do anything. You just hold it, you don't check the share price, nothing. So what do you get? Okay, you know, the result that $24,000 has become $156,000. That is over 21 years. And your annualized return is 9.3%. This is just from your 1998 portfolio. So in 1999, you save your salary and then you continue to do the same process and you buy the stocks starting with A. In Singapore, it's ACMA. In Hong Kong, Eon Stores, Eon Company. It's just that you have a lot of Eon because it starts with A and E, you know. So you have a heavy allocation to Eon. And your overall return is annualized return, if you look at it, is 9.2%. So you grow money from 24,000 to 139,000 over 20 years. Remember again, what you did was just to buy the shares and to hold it. You made no adjustment or whatsoever. Okay, of course there will be some bad years. Later I summarize all the years. So in 2007, which was actually stocks were going at a high just before the financial crisis. So you look at it, you have three stocks that blew up. Asia Travel, Amex, Amplefuel from Singapore, Hong Kong and Malaysia, which you almost lost all your money. So 2007 cohort or batch did very poorly. And your 24,000 annual savings that you did declined to 21,000. So your annualized return is minus 1.1%. So this is not a good result. So you imagine that you do this for 20 years. After 20 years, you will have 120 stocks in your portfolio. And you just buy and hold. It's a very simple strategy, and you just need the fortitude and the discipline to implement it, and maybe a bit of madness. So let me show you that entire bunch. You can see that from 1998, this is a summarized table, to 2008. If you look at the annualized return on the last column, 1998 batch, you got 9.3% annualized. 1999, 9.2%. 7.2, 10.3, 10.7, 6.0, and so on. You see that the result is actually quite good. And what is so wonderful about this? You don't have to pay any fees. So this is zero management fees and zero performance fees. Even better than aggregate. Of course, there will be some batches which didn't do well. 2007, 2008, it was negative. Okay, let's look at 2009 to 2018. So again, you know, it's the same thing. You look at the annualized return on the right-hand side. 8.5, 5.4, 10.2, 9.8, and so on. Pretty good results, right? So why do you need a fund manager? And if you move downwards, you see that there are some years, 2016, 2017, 2018, you had minus returns. Okay, there are a few reasons. One is that these are relatively recent. It's just formed just 2 or 3 years ago. Second reason is that you only had 6 stocks for each cohort, for each batch. So that's why there will be some variability in it. But if you sum up everything, what you did for 21 years, what you have is you have put in a total of, look at the last line, a total of 500,000, and you actually have 1.3 million. And an annualized return, overall annualized return of 8.3%. Isn't that amazing? There's some reason why this can happen. I will explain the reason now. Okay, if you don't have any time and you just want to invest in a diversified portfolio, what do? You can buy the index, right? So now I have compared that result with the various index. So you have invested in S&P 500 from 1998 to now, your return is 6.6%. This is including dividends. SDI, 3.67%. Kuala Lumpur, 8.56%. This is the annualized return over 21 years. Of course, KL, I didn't adjust for the Malaysian ringgit depreciation. But overall, your average return is 5.72% by investing in the index, in the ETFs. But if you have used the A to Z 5-minute, very seems stupid method, you have gotten 8.26%. That is a 3% outperformance. So, investing actually cannot be made any more simple than this. This is the most simple. All you need to know is just A, B, C, and how to sort the stocks by alphabetical order. So, an 8.326% from this approach is it means fivefold return over 21 years. So that's why you shouldn't be afraid of stocks, because even a simple process like this can bring you to a very satisfactory return. So that's why you shouldn't be afraid of stocks. Okay, if you look at it, out of this entire list of 120 over stocks that you have accumulated, 18 of them actually lost more than 80%. That is quite serious, right? But because you have 126, 18 is almost like 15% of your portfolio got decimated. And just for fun, I tabulated which countries where the stock actually lost almost all its money. So Singapore, well known for corporate governance, right? Six of them completely wiped out. Malaysia, known for bad corporate governance, only two. Japan, zero. Okay, this is just an interesting diversion. Next, 14 stocks gained more than 500%. And you know, they are all over, so I didn't tabulate by country. The results are good, despite a seemingly random selection. The process is designed, even though it may look a bit mad. It is designed to take advantage of the small cap effect, the value effect, the diversification principle, equal weighting, remember each stock is equally weighted, and the business effect. So this is the first time that I will explain the business effect. If explain it later, you know the small cap effect, you know the value effect already. So this method also overcomes psychological behavioral limitations. Because when you use this method, it is a random method where you randomly select the A stocks or whatever that you want. You can select by your name, E or B or Z or whatever. Anyway, Z performed the best. So the random element is important, because if you go around, just say my kid implement this strategy and he go around and ask his friend, hey, my dad told me to do this, you know, to buy the A stock. The stock is called Acme or something. Then the friend say, your dad is crazy. Don't listen to him. You should buy Bitcoin. Or a few years ago, your dad is silly. You shouldn't do that. You should buy an Iskandar property. So don't ever communicate with anybody when you run this strategy, because they will tell you otherwise. Then the third point is no market timing, no cash drag. Remember, you hold the stocks until today. You didn't time the market. You didn't have any cash drag. Usually people hold cash and they wonder what to do with it. They wait for a better time and so on. So in this case, what I tell my kid, she's not confused, because she knows that her mission in life is to collect from A to Z. That's all. The mission is simple, it's clear. Nobody asks you to keep cash. You are supposed to collect all the animals from A to Z. Then another thing is, it's not a rojak portfolio. So you don't have things that drag you down in a rojak portfolio. I think a lot of you understand rojak portfolio, but later I explain what is rojak portfolio. This is not a rojak portfolio. It is not a hodgepodge of underperforming assets. It is 100% stocks, this strategy. It is a 10% compounded return rocket fuel. And it is equal weighting. You don't feel that I like something, I buy more. I don't like something, I buy less. You know, you don't make that behavioral mistake. Then, of course, it eliminates analysis paralysis. Every day, you don't have to analyze who is going to win, China or US. You don't have to analyze anything. You just need to sort A to Z. So it eliminates analysis paralysis. So this is the number one killer. I mean, there are a lot of people who are starting out in their careers and they have kids and they are trying to save money for their retirement fund. So they are not exactly financially sufficient yet. So I call these people the poor millionaires. They have $1 million, they have $2 million, but they still feel very poor. Right? So if you are a poor millionaire, you cannot afford to have a rojak portfolio. So what I mean by rojak portfolio? Okay, you have some fixed deposits, cash, $500,000. Okay, it earns 2%. You're waiting for the opportunity that is going to come. So there's only 2% earning you. Then the second one, you have investment property, $1.5 million. Your rental yield is 2%. Your capital gain and appreciation depends on government action. Iskandar property is half. Bitcoin is gone. Some perpetual bonds are gone. You have some good quality bonds at 4%. You have some invested in a gold scheme a long time ago. Now you still have the gold bar. Your friend's cafe business, you know, half gone. Your own business idea, you have 100,000 set aside for that, but you are still thinking about it. You haven't started anything yet. So overall, what do you have? You have an overall return of 1.5% on your rojak portfolio. So if you are a poor millionaire, you can't afford to have this. So this rule of 72, Kevin Tok, my partner, the guy who forced me to come out here to speak, he teach me the rule of 72. At 1.5%, you take 67 years to double your rojak portfolio. At 10% overall return, you take 7 years to double your portfolio. It's a huge difference. Especially if you have a small family and you are having a career. So having said that, now I explain the why this so-called randomly portfolio, why it actually work. Okay, the small cap effect. Xia Ying talked about the small cap effect. So I break down the stocks in the stock market. More than 1 billion, there are 95 stocks. So these are the blue chip and all that. This is a Singapore stock market. Then 100 to 500 million, there are 140 stocks. Less than 100 million, there are 367 stocks. What I'm trying to tell you here is that there are a huge percentage of stocks that are small cap. So if you randomly choose your portfolio, 70% of them will be in that small cap space. And that is what helped the A to Z portfolio, the random portfolio, generate the return because of the small cap effect. Then the next thing is the value effect. Value effect, as explained earlier, the price to book. You break down the stock market into the different price to book stocks. So if you notice the fourth line, less than 1.0 times price to book, there are 400 stocks there. So it means that in the overall stock market, 60%, they are low price to book stocks. So when you choose randomly, a lot of it will fall into this low price to book stock. And that explains your outperformance as well. So you get that 2-3% outperformance is from all this effect. So lastly, putting in some common sense to things, what are you truly investing in when you're investing in stocks? You're investing in businesses. So this is the business effect. What is the business effect? Business effect is when you go out there and you start a business, what kind of returns can you get? So on average, you can get 10% returns a year. You know, 10% return on capital, meaning that if you put in $1 million, you are going to get back 100,000 of profits. This is the worldwide effect. Any listed company on average earn 10% ROE. So you look at, I split the three countries, US, Shanghai Stock Exchange, and Singapore. I show you the ROE trends over the last many years. So if you look at it, the US, people talk about the decline in US, but you look at US carefully, they have the highest ROE at 16%. Shanghai, 11%. So there's some kind of a magic sauce in the US companies that allow them to earn 16% return on equity on the capital. China, so they just copy and make stuff and sell it cheap. So they have 11% return on equity. So they have less. Singapore, 8%. So overall, the main thing is that in any business, you can make 10% return on equity. That's basically the gist of it. And the reason why you need to diversify is it comes from this slide. You can't just invest in Singapore. This is the ROE of the Singapore stock market from 2005 to 2018. Can you see that in general, listed companies in Singapore, the orange line is a big cap, is on a decline. Orange line is big capitalization stocks, the index stocks. So in Singapore, you are earning about 10%. It has declined to 10% from a high of 21%. What about smaller companies listed on the Singapore Stock Exchange? If you look at it, it's also on the decline. And what is surprising to me is that listed small companies in Singapore, they are earning negative returns for the last 3 to 4 years. So to me, I mean, I'm not going to take sides whether Singapore is going to thrive or not, or their ROEs is going to get better. But all I know is that I cannot put all my money into Singapore. So that's why in the 5-minute strategy, you should just choose 5 to 6 stock markets and start with A. That will keep you safe. Now, this is the business effect. So this one is a bit harder to explain, but I'll try. So if on average, the whole world ROE is 10%, you invest in any business, you get 10%. So if you invest $1 as capital, the $1 to buy machines, to buy stocks, to renovate your shop, okay, you are going to get back 10 cents profit. That's what I mean. You start any business, you are going to get back 10 cents profit. The ROE is not the same as the share price. The share price is what people pay you for. What you started is $1 capital. But what people buy from you could be $2 or $3. $1 is your capital that you use to start the business. So there's a difference there. So on average, in Singapore and in the world, right, if the business earns 10 cents, 4 cents will be paid to you as dividends on average in the world. 6 cents will be reinvested in the company. This is called the retained earnings. So your book value, which you started the company with $1, after 1 year, you got 6 cents, and that 6 cents is added back into your capital. So the book value is $1.06. And if the company continue to maintain a 10% ROE, which is very possible because the world average is 10%, 10% times the $1.06, now you will earn 10.6 cents. So what it means is this. The company makes money, it gives out some as dividends, some it puts back inside, and if you continue to earn that 10%, the book value will keep increasing, and not only that, the earnings will keep increasing as well, because you have a larger base. Okay, I think it's very hard to see this, but just look at the orange line in the book value. You can see the book value, $1, $1.06, $1.12, $1.19, $1.26, $1.34, because of the retained earnings. Look at dividends per share. I told you they pay out 40% as dividends. So over time, dividends per share, the blue line, 4 cents, 4.2 cents, 4.5 cents, 4.8 cents, 5 cents, 5.4 cents. So you have increasing dividends. Why? It's not that the company is doing well. The company is just earning 10% returns on capital. It's just that the capital has grown bigger. It's not magic. It's like you have a savings account. Just say you earn 1% on $1. After a while, your interest on interest, it will keep growing. Your book value will keep growing. There's nothing magical about that. It's not that the company is doing well. Okay, then the next thing, you look at the earnings per share, the yellow line. Because of the bigger base, it earned 10 cents, 10.6 cents, 11.2 cents, 11.9 cents, and so on. It's just not magic, it's just reinvested capital. So this is the difference between investing in stocks and other assets. You have a growing capital base, you have a 10% ROE, so everything grows over time. So how do you calculate this growth in book value? Okay, how you calculate is the ROE multiplied by what is retained. So on average, ROE is 10%, what is retained is 60%, so means that your book values grow at 6% a year, which you don't see. All you see is the stock market price. All you see are commentators commenting on the economy and telling you about this, about that, and making you feel very worried. You don't even see this 6% growth a year that is inside the book value. So this is why you shouldn't be afraid of stocks. Because whether the market goes up or down or whatever, your book value is growing at 6%, your capital is growing at 6%. It's just that you don't see it. And later, the share price will catch up with that. So book value grows at 6%. This protects you. Dividends, you get 1%, 2%. That's how you get your 7% to 8% return. Remember I told you about the 5-minute random portfolio? Now I work out for you why you actually got 8% return. Because your book value grows at 6%, your dividend grows at 1-2, your dividend is 1-2%, you get the 7-8% return. It's a no-brainer. So everybody, you know, if they know this, then they will not be very worried. Why I explain this is because in 2018 last year, we have some new investors, so they feel discouraged because for six or seven months, the aggregate value fund, when you receive your report, every month you see it declining. So you ask, when is the end? Is the end here? Are we doomed? Are we finished? Did I make a very terrible mistake? So actually, I'm not worried about the stock market. I'm only worried when our investors are worried. But actually, there's nothing to worry about. That's what I'm trying to say here. So if you look at the business, there's really nothing to worry about. So this brings us back to a bond. You think that bonds are safe, but you notice from what I show you that with just a consistent 10% ROE, your dividends are growing. Your book value is growing. Whereas if you buy a bond, your book value is your principal. It doesn't grow. You buy it at $100. After 10 years, they return you $100. Whereas the book value grow, and your dividends grow and your earnings grow. So why would you want to buy a bond? A bond is lending money to people. Why do you want to lend money to people? And when they close shop, you also lost money on your bond. You should be an equity holder. You should own the business. You shouldn't be a debtor. So that's why the 5-minute process doesn't account for bonds. It's just 100% equity. So if you are in equity, some of our clients, most of their money with us, so we have to learn how to manage the risk. That is why we do not have a 30-stock portfolio. If I have a 30-stock portfolio and I have a 10% position in one stock, I may do extraordinarily well, but I can do extraordinarily bad. I don't want to subject, you know, people who place a lot of money with us, I don't want to subject their retirement fund for that. So that is why we have a lot more stocks to cater for this risk and also to earn that 10% ROE. The 10% ROE comes from an aggregate of the entire world portfolio stock. So you want that. So back to this, the share price fluctuates, but it has to track book value growth over the long term. Okay, just to give you a concrete example of what I mean. If you look at the white line of United Overseas Bank from 2002 to 2019, look at the white line. The white line is the share price of United Overseas Bank. It was as low as $10 in 2002, right at the left. Then you can see that the share price is on an increasing trend. So before the financial crisis, it went as high as $22. After the financial crisis, it declined. Then it bounced back up. But overall, if you look at United Overseas Bank share price, it's on the up over the long term. Why is this so? It's based on that principle of the reinvestment of book value, which I told you. Book value grows at 6% a year. The green line is actually the book value. Book value means the liquidation value of United Overseas Bank. Look at the green line. The green line is more consistent, it's more stable. The reason is because of the reinvested earnings growing at 6%. It doesn't change. It grows at 6%, 6%, 6%, 6%, 6%. Some years the ROE may be bad, then it declined a bit. The pink line shows you the ROE. If you look at the ROE of UOB, it's about 12% on average. So if ROE is 12%, payout ratio is 50%, book value should grow at 6%, 50 times 12, okay, 6%. The green line is that. If you look at it further, you look, the $22 dropped to $10 in 2008. At $10, it's close to the book value. You have gotten a bank at close to book value, at liquidation value. And just recently in 2016, where I gave the talk 3 years ago, I highlighted UOB also. At that time, UOB was $18. And book value was $18. So after that, you know, you can see that it trades at a premium to book value. Only certain events will cause it to be near the book value. So this is called value investing. Value investing means that you buy things which are close to the book value or below the book value. So is value investing going to go out of fashion? The answer is no. I mean, why would buying cheap and selling high go out of fashion? Okay, in the same chart, you can see growth investing. You'll be at $22 in 2007. You look at the ROE, the pink line. In 2007, the ROE was 17%. That is great. 17% ROE on a business. Not many businessmen can make 17% on their capital. So UOB, you can see, is a growth story in 2007. And that is why people are willing to pay $22 and on a book value of $11, which means 2 times price to book. People are willing to pay 2 times more the liquidation value of UOB. and that's a growth stock, right? But if you buy it at $22, you can you see how long it takes book value to catch up? Until today, at this point of speaking, if you bought at $22 a long time ago, today the book value is $21. So what it means is that you have to wait very, very long for the green line, the book value line, the liquidation value line, to catch up with what you paid. So price is very important. It's not whether it's a good stock or a bad stock or whatever. You buy UOB at $22, you are stupid. You buy at $10, you are smart. So a good stock, a stock can make someone smart or stupid, or can make someone a growth investor or a value investor, is the same stock. So we are not interested in discussing specific stocks. Now I explain to you why. This is the last slide. So this is the... people ask me, why Aggregate has 600 stocks? How do you manage 600 stocks? Okay, this is the answer. Can you shut all the video? I don't want people to know this. So, no, just joking. So, if I sort the entire stock market, Japan, Korea, Hong Kong, Australia, Malaysia, Indonesia, Thailand, Taiwan, I randomly sample 2,000-3,000 stocks. I rank them on the chart by book values. So the lowest book value is number one, followed by number two, number three, number four, all the way to 2,300. So you can see that there are 2,300 stocks there. Okay, so if I were to buy the lowest price to book stock, if I were to just buy 150 of them, which I show the number 150, can you see that your returns is not good enough? It doesn't reach the average return that you are going to get. If I buy 460 stocks, then I average the return of the 460 stocks, then you can see that I approach the return that is the average return from this portfolio. So, if you own 30 stocks, in a normal academic paper, you own 30 stocks and you think that you are diversified. Sorry, you are not. From here, to get out of the danger zone. The danger zone can be very good. You could have chosen Alibaba and it could have done very well. But from here, you can see to get into the average zone, you have to have at least 500 stocks. So that's why we have 500 stocks, because we don't want to lose. It's better to start off not wanting to lose than wanting to win big. That's what the Aggregate Value Fund is designed for. Okay, this one just a quick one for young people. Take the middle line. You earn 100,000 salary, your expense is $50,000, you save $50,000. So your savings ratio is 50%. You save 50% of your salary. The retirement amount you need is 1.25 million. I get that by multiplying 25 times your expenses. So you need 1.25 million to save out your retirement fund. How long will you need to do that? That's 25 years. You look at the top line. If your savings ratio is 10%, you only save 10% of your salary. The years it takes you to save your retirement pool is 225 years. Actually, there's someone in the audience that is right at the bottom. He's one of our clients. He retired in 6 years because his expense ratio is 20% and his savings ratio is 80%. So in summary, we want to go to the asset class with the highest return, and we manage a risk by diversification across to 600 stocks. We understand the growth in book values will help manage your fear of price volatilities. And think in terms of a portfolio, not in terms of a stock. So there's no point to ask what you think of stock XYZ. It doesn't mean anything. Then lastly, overhaul your Rojak portfolio. Thank you very much. Before that, I'd like to introduce David. David, he's going to present what we have been working on. David is a client of us for many years. I didn't know him in the beginning. He was a client. So I met up with David over a couple of sessions. And as I, when I first met him, you know, I know that he's a very smart guy. He does risk management and, you know, he's just smart. Then as I get to know him longer, not only is he smart, he's also wise. So he's here because I actually worked with him for the last 2 to 3 years. And instead of golfing after his retirement, he wants to do more risk management, and we are developing statistical learning, machine learning on new ways of looking at things. So, you know, that's an informal introduction. Let David come up and speak. Thank you.